Mr. Siler.
I'm going to go through quite a few slides, tell some stories, and we'll have some guests, special guests and friends that will talk about the future of innovation. And we'll probably ask many of the same questions that I've been asking myself about how we come to know innovation, what the process is, whether there is a single process, will it change over time? What will we learn from the various kinds of ways that we innovate and grow? And not just grow our lives, but kind of grow our future. And that's what I'm going to be talking about tonight. I'm going to do my own risk and jumping off cliffs and things and do things that are rather uncharacteristic of me. But it is about these timeless tools, ageless tools and ways and experiences. And I'll talk about tools and methods and approaches and all sorts of things. But in the context of building a sustainability and a sustainable future. And I'm going to noodle on that a little bit, and I'm going to need you to noodle on that as you're thinking about it, because I started reading and getting into the literature some years ago about sustainability, and I find that everyone has very different notions of it. And you can't read everyone's mind, but we're going to talk about these two things. You know, the innovation process needs to be rooted in the concept of sustainability from my perspective, and not simply market economics or the myopia that we tend to fall into, just, you know, following what the market's doing, whatever the markets are doing. It's very Darwinian. It, you know, we follow along that course. I'm going to talk about these hands-on and minds-on experiential learning tools and thinking tools and things and resources that really do help us power and drive innovation. And I think they will be doing that over the next thousands of years if we survive. And the third point is, that rests on that second point, is without improving human communication and understanding, I think the whole sustainability issue is moot. I think it will fall by chance, and that's the larger kind of premise I'm putting out there. And it's a very serious issue, and I'll try not to get too serious about it, because I do like to joke around and get some humor in this, but those are the main topics. And I got to reframe and step way back, take the Spinoza perspective, happened to like that rationalist philosopher. He felt that all the ailments of civilization were because we did not have that. We didn't live with our eyes on eternity in the present, in the here and now. Because it's very humbling when you do that, because you're in a constant learning, growing, searching process. And so that larger perspective and that little star there is just meant to be where we are in that one galaxy. And here, that one galaxy is one of 400,000 galaxies in this mosaic that was brought to us via the Hubble and other information gathering things that allow us to take the big perspective. It's just daunting when you think about it. That's just a small piece of the cosmos. And I actually find it very exciting to look at nature, keep coming back to nature, much like many inventors, innovators have done over a lifetime, and to cast everything in that context and really say, for me, I feel nature has invented everything and human nature simply innovates. And we discover that in the various kinds of issues and topics that we read, from biomimicry to what I call process morphology, looking at things comparatively across processes in different areas. But I start with that quote from Bucky Fuller, whom I absolutely look at as just one of those quintessential thinkers. We've had lots of them throughout the ages, but he just blows my mind because, in fact, he did give the essence of himself in the service of humankind. And you'll see a little more notes on that. But there's something to that statement that is daunting, because we live in a highly compartmentalized world. We've learned to divide, differentiate, compartmentalize, and specialize. We're brilliant at it. It what put us into space and built the Hubble and everything else that we know, and allows us to make the kind of progression in science and technology, math, engineering, and so forth that we're doing at light speed. But we got to also stand back and reintegrate things. And one of the things I learned from watching and working with kids all the time is they live in an absolute fluid state of information ideas. Anything could be anything. Everything could be connected to everything. There's no boundaries and categories of things until we teach them so, you know, where they start at 18 months, they're fluidly taking sticks and transforming them into any number of objects and things. There's no limit to what they are or can be or how they purpose them until we say, no, that's a piece of wood. It weighs a certain amount of mass, and this is what you do with it, and don't think of doing anything else with it. And so bit by bit, we shut that lens down. So I'm going to be asking you some fundamental questions that have come to us a long way. They've come to us, we all think about them, and again, I'm trying to wrap, get the bigger picture. We can all answer a question like this that Paul Gauguin asked, and he actually just resounded what the ancient wisdom has asked over and over, whence do we come, what are we, where are we going? You ask anybody running an organization or a business, they can answer that instantly, hopefully they can, and you know, they know their vision, mission, goals, tasks, and things in the here and now. But when you add that dimension of time over a year, 10 years, 100 years, that becomes a really, really interesting question. And that plays into the tools that we're inventing and using to help us gain insight into that. Because that question, those questions, are core to asking ourselves what a sustainable future is about. So tonight, I'm going to be talking about tools, processes, minds-on, hands-on tools and things to help us envision what we want to create and create what we envision. Because I find, and you'll see, many examples of thousands of organizations out there that have all kinds of answers and solutions to things, but they're like delivering the carts before the horse. You know, we haven't stopped and asked ourselves, no, wait a second, what is this thing that we're talking about that is sustainable? And how is it sustainable? And what are the mechanisms to doing that? So those are the kinds of questions. And I'm going to raise this one. I'll read it just for those who don't have a Hubble cell and they can't see in the back. We are not what we know. We are what we're willing to learn. That statement came out of a week's worth of focus and concentration at the Gahan Foundation that had a Council for Ideas and Alan Kay, who is credited for bringing the laptop and ideas and so forth. He worked at the Media Lab many years. We all huddled for a weekend and we decided, we were asked a question, what's the most urgent problem in the world and what is it? How would you articulate it? And we decided it was all about learning. That learning, the act and the inability and ability to learn was really at the essence of it. And I find that, and you'll see that in some of the slides, that in fact, that's what it is. So this statement really gets around one of the core issues of innovation for me is the humility of standing back and asking constantly, what else do I need to reframe my perspective in order to see larger and further? So this beautiful image, this visualization of a portion of the internet, I find is remarkable because it's showing how we're trying to integrate every kind of resource tool imaginable, like take infinite numbers of information, ideas, resources, and compress them and make them connect, where we begin to see the larger connectivity of everything. And I'm startled by it because there's probably as many connections envisioned as that as someone like Lynn Conway, who helped invent very large storage integration systems and get people thinking about how we mass information, aggregate it, sort through it, connect it, all that kind of stuff. I look at that image and I say, "What? That's what it is. This is what it was maybe 5 years ago. What is it going to be in the next 10 years? And what are the tools that are going to grow this?" So, what is that door to innovation? And what are we looking through? What are we going through and into? And what are we seeing? And so I wanted to take a look at innovation sort of from the nutshell, the essence for me. It comes down to creativity and communication, and I'm going to break that down still further. And will those be the same issues, and what's nested in that, in 1,000 years from now? And I tend to, when I do my work, I tend to have a very long view and say, will any of this stuff be relevant 10 years or 100 years or 500 or 1,000 years and so forth. And so for me, under the creativity piece, I find that if the openness isn't there, then none of the other stuff, the curiosity, imagination, critical thinking, understanding is not going to be there too. So the first, very first thing is working on that sense of openness and how you keep an open mind to continually invent and innovate. So we look at that and we all use the word creativity. We know it's important to innovation. We don't know quite where it plays in there. And we don't quite know how to measure it either, because it's been years and people are still trying to build an assessment and evaluation for how you measure creativity other than through intellectual property and what you do and how you apply that IP in tangible ways in business. But it's far more than that, and there are many other layers to creativity that we're still trying to figure out, much like communication. So under the communication, I have vision, empathy, connection, cooperation, and collaboration. And again, I don't think any of those other previous things will happen without having that spark of vision. And I find that often. How many of you have encountered that when you're working? We've spent 15 years consulting, helping large corporations innovate, and often the problem is that, you know, when people have the vision, mission, goals, tasks, so forth, all the way down, we find that the misalignment is happening everywhere, and that's why nothing really gets done, and everyone lives in a state of tyranny of the urgent, and you know, it's a general morass. And what's interesting is, how do we deal with those basics and explore that? So I want to flash this image up. It was a special Newsweek image from Davos of folks who are looking at, standing at that threshold of 2,000 years and looking out and saying, gee, how are we going to go forward? What are we going to have to do, practice, think, our behaviors and so forth differently in order to grow? And I was thinking, how many books and resources and experiences we've all had that, some of which are in here. I don't know if you're familiar with the Change Handbook. They're all about various kinds of practices for working with organizations, large-scale change, to make change happen and grow, and various other books like Robert Root Bernstein and Michelle Root Bernstein's Sparks of Genius, which looks at 13 thinking tools and processes that we can use to make breakthroughs happen all the time. They're used in science and technology, engineering, math, and the arts to make all kinds of breakthroughs happen. So there's just a bounty of literature that plays in there, as well as this one book on the corner up there. It's by Warren Bennis, and it is called Organizing Genius. A really fascinating book, looks at different case studies of what makes genius teams, you know, the Pixars and Disney and so forth. What is that special alchemy that people can innovate from and around? We all have our own books we can think of to add to that list. Csikszentmihalyi's Creativity Flow, around discovery and the process of discovery and invention. We all have our own particular list, so I invite you to add and think of your own lists of books and things you want to put in there. And for me, when we look at best practices, what are those things? What do those things mean for you? And how will we be applying them? And how does the process of innovation work in each of them? Or streamlining operations, or making things more effective and efficient? We all have different notions of those things, but I can't read your mind, and you can't read mine, and we have to find some way of actually being able to show and demonstrate to one another what those concepts mean to us, and the realities behind them that are nested in them. And that's part of the invitation. We also know what happens when none of those things are applied and everything goes haywire. And this is the thing that I fear most about our prospect of moving forward without really having a sense of creativity innovation, that we are brilliant at knowing things. And it says, knowledge is understanding our mistakes, wisdom is learning from them. We are absolutely brilliant and knowledgeable about our mistakes, but we don't necessarily learn from them, so we repeat them continuously and very incrementally make those changes happen. And I'm saying, if we're going to have a sustainable future, maybe that has to change. Maybe we have to find another way of learning. So this is the 50,000-foot kind of perspective, kind of moving down this stream into here. So given all that, I'm going to read this. How far into the future do we need to see to change certain patterns of human behavior today that work against us or our development as human beings and that weaken our humanity or sense of civil society? When you ask those questions, I know that most people running a business today don't ask themselves that. They're neck deep, again, having worked with companies. They're not thinking about these big issues or whether it's going to, you know, whether they have to be involved or can't they just leave it to the creatives at the think tanks, you know, to come up with that? Why can't they just leave it to all the folks at various corporations, Rand, Hudson Institute, to come up with those solutions and we'll just simply follow them? Well, I have a problem with that because, in fact, I think everyone has something to contribute and everyone has some original insights and experiences that need to play into this. And they have their own vision of it, and we need to hear from all of those people. We need to see our individual visions of what a sustainable future can be. So here's a good example and a question that Buckminster Fuller threw for his the Bucky Fuller Challenge, and it is, if success or failure of the planet and of human beings depended on how I am and what I do, how would I be, what would I do? And so you're reflecting back on yourselves and saying, what tools of innovation that are familiar to you or unfamiliar that you'd like to experiment with to answer that, to grow from, to apply to your life, your work, your company, your community, your nation? And so that is a question I come back to quite a bit. I won't read all this, but Bucky Fuller was very big on cooperation, not competition. He said that would, you know, signify the next step of human evolution, and that he wanted us to focus on not the development of weaponry, but livingry. You know, things that were actually going to promote our growth, wellness, and all those issues that, again, most of us running our businesses, daily businesses, don't really think about this stuff. But maybe we need to devote a certain amount of time to. That's the proposition here and the premise that if we're going to build something that absolutely lasts and grows, I think we need to think about these kinds of questions. And so his notion, he referred to himself as the trim tab, you know, the little device that trails on a rudder that absolutely, like a lever, moves you in a certain direction, and that we're all trim tabs, you know. I think we have to give that some thought and think about tools, resources, and things that we can use to grow and move forward. So I ask you this question, what does sustainable future mean to you? Okay, and I'm certain you've come across lots of organizations like World Changing, Alex Steffen's work, World Changing, it's terrific. I urge you to look at that, worldchanging.com. They have many, many thousands of solutions-based journalists and writing about all kinds of opportunities and tangible, actionable things that are going on currently to build a sustainable future. You know, they're building the carts, they feel that the solutions are already out there and that we simply need to recognize them and act on them and grow from them and build. But I'm also suggesting that we also need to stop a moment and say, well, where's all this going and what would we like it to end up? And that statement of a sustainable development, you know, it's meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of the future generations to meet their own needs into the infinite or indefinite future using currently available technology. My feeling about technology is we can technology ourselves to death. And I find again that we probably have all the technology and technological solutions readily available, but again, that human communication piece is very much missing. And I find that as we become increasingly more technologically connected, we are growing increasingly disconnected, conceptually, culturally, and so forth, in a very curious way. So I think we need to look at that order of magnitude, that 80% of the human communication piece and the 20% technology, and we got it all reversed. We're so focused on the 80% tech and that 20% of the human improving that I find that we're going to fall into that pattern of endless crises, some of which are noted. So if you looked at the number of links on sustainable future 10 years ago, trust me, it would be nothing compared to what is mushrooming now at this point. So clearly, people's eyes and minds, and their organizations are kind of centered on that, and they're moving forward in a positive way. And they're finding ways of using all kinds of technologies and problem-solving tools to come up with not just the technological solutions, but ways of managing that. And so that, to me, is very exciting. How involved are the youth in all this? That is something that might be, if you drill down and looked and made a search of that, how many of them involve, you know, different aspects of the younger generation that are here to grow with this. I don't know what those numbers are, but that would be a very interesting thing to parse and see, you know. But there are just thousands of organizations and forums that are really committed at this point, and that's a very encouraging sign. They are not necessarily taught innovation skills and tools and resources and things in school. That is not a topic of discussion necessarily, any more than 10 years ago, critical thinking was looked at as one slice in the standards material, the national standards material in this country, as opposed to it being integrated in all different fields. So I want to just move quickly here. It's innovation, fast flow, that's one aspect of flow to it. But like the Hokusai, his painting, this floating world where people are in these boats, I don't know if you can see them, they're all working collaboratively. That's that constant sea. The waves are constant, the turbulence is constant, the instability is constant. And in fact, that is our constant that we have to be innovating and working with consistently all the time. That's the normal state of things. Much like the normal state of the cosmos is complete, utter violence and chaos and unpredictable motion of masses of energy and information. And that's the state of the universe all the time. I feel the innovation process is naturally messy. I don't want to show you all the process flow diagrams. I went through that looking and trying to think of all of the resources and tools that we have built to put products and processes through various gate systems to evaluate them and so forth. That, to me, this is closer, this estuary, this messiness is closer to what I see happening. And I go back to this image of DaVinci looking at and always beginning and looking inward at himself and nature and unraveling those mysteries, much like he using nature as the kind of ultimate authority to look at, tease apart, and try to understand the dynamics. I put that image of the brain there because, in fact, everything that we're learning about learning, how we learn, how we innovate, is becoming more and more brain-based. There's so much literature and work on that, and my passion and interest is looking at the biological basis of creativity, kind of like how we learn, how we discover, how we invent from the inside out. What's going on in our bodies, in our nervous systems, to even begin to think differently or use information in new ways? What does that look like, that state of change and transformation in the body? So that part is very relevant. I deal with this fear. Many of you came across this article in Newsweek many years ago. It was right after 9/11, and people were experiencing enormous stress, and they were trying to figure out what we know about fear. What's that? It says, yeah, it's 2000. Well, they should call it last week, but here it is. It's Newsweek, February 2003, and this is just, we know so much now from the neuroscience side about the pathways of fear and chronic stress and what happens in our nervous systems. And, you know, some people use fear as a catalyst for change and growth, and others are just paralyzed by it. And probably more and more, I'd say the paralysis part far dominates over the excitation part. But the neuroscience that we're learning about how literally fear interferes with the creative process and shuts down the innovation process. How many of times have we been in sessions where we are terrified to open our mouths because we don't look stupid? I remember when I was teaching MIT, I'd have a class full of brilliant kids, and I know they did not want to ask basic questions because they didn't want to be silly. They didn't want to ask a silly question. And it was that silly question. It was that thing that absolutely would turn a whole conversation around or get someone to do peace action research, go deeper, dive down, come back with a little exploration and report out, say, you know, we have to go and try something differently here. So, but the pathway, this, anything you can read about the pathways and the process of what fear does to us in actually shutting down the creative process. You know, we all have our stories, we all have our fear stories of not wanting to go down, being risk adverse, not just in the companies and groups we work with, but what that feels like in ourselves. And it's not a particularly inviting feeling, but anyway, it's worth looking at. So this chaos in that painting there of all these fragmented, different, disassociated pieces of information, ideas that are coming at us, and that line of, that bolt line of insight or intuition that we rocket for and look for. Most of us live in that state of that chaotic moment of trying to piece all those elements together. It almost looks like, you know, a chunk of the cosmos you saw before, all happening in the mind. Well, I remember doing research at MIT on this, trying to look at the biology behind this, what happens in our nervous systems when we're inventing, innovating, discovering, what we go through as we're trying to visualize a new idea, a new concept, and then express it. So probably that image or painting depicts that compression, that environment that you see in there on Wall Street as we're processing data. Imagine living in that space and that environment, much like our kids do, when they are looking at all this input, this excitement of work and thinking coming in there, but not taking the time necessarily to stop and reflect on the connections between those experiences they're learning. So what are they absorbing? You know, it's just a kind of a reflex action process. How long could you live in that state? You know, much like a fighter pilot trying to make unbelievable tactical decisions in split seconds and trying to gather from the information, all the different elements that have to be thought about and referenced. And so the learning process is much like this. That Diane Arbus image there of the little boy holding the hand grenade, it's a very famous image. I'm drawn to it. I won't tell you the history and anything behind it, but it was just, seems to me, symbolic of our, the culture we're creating from this utterly stressed out, pushed to the edge, you know, the cortisol, you know, kicked in versus the freedom to be childlike and, you know, discover things. So I want to turn to this image, this Hewlett-Packard image of, it says, all kids are inventive and inventors. And I have to summon in each of us that we are constantly inventing and innovating for ourselves when we're given a curious problem to work on. And we're not afraid to make all the mistakes we want to do, and we dream, and we do all these other kinds of things. And I feel that in that moment, what we're doing and allowing ourselves to do is do genius thinking, which is to see things not simply for what they are, but what they can be with imagination, and how they absolutely, and in fact, everyone has that capacity in them. It's most dormant in most of us because, in fact, we shut it down very early on in life when we shut the aperture of our vision down and those other qualities I was saying under the creativity and communication piece. And we feel very isolated, much like that Giacometti sculpture of those isolated people. And for me, genius is this ability to actually look through the essence of something and see through the complexity, much like that figure is anticipating, looking through something, and then seeing it through, then seeing it and realizing it through. Much like this technician who's doing a functional MRI and is looking to the essence of the human body, the nervous system, how it's behaving, and prescribing a treatment for it. So it's that, never mind the complexity of the equipment to actually do that neuroimaging, but in essence, it's looking through that complexity to find elements of it. And I feel we can never make the obvious enough about the innovation process. It says, what's the point of pointing? And I love this statement by Warren McCullen, who is a famous neuroscientist. And every time he would introduce a new theory. He'd say, don't bite my finger, look where I'm pointing. Because there's stuff we can do when we point at something, because we don't have the words, we have the absolute connection, we have the intuition, or the blink, or that thing that we know is right intuitively, but we don't have the words for it. So we have the sense of it. And I look at how many times we look at an individual and we have no sense of what they're about, what they're thinking about, what we'd like them to think about. And they may be thinking about patterns in nature, much like the Weybridge, you know, those patterns and looking at patterns and gazing about that. They may be thinking about recycling things, and you wouldn't know that unless you invited them to actually give form to their thoughts. They may be thinking about how that larger connectivity, much like those images I showed you brought to us from the Hubble, you know, and that is a diagram from Brian Greene. How many of you are fans of Brian Greene? Guy who thinks in metaphors, loves how that larger connectivity works, and, you know, from taking an apple and looking all the way down to these infinite levels of detail in matter, how is all that stuff connected? And that individual might be thinking about that. And also about how the brain, the absolute observer going on in all this. And we'll find that in education, our schools, we don't necessarily are taught or engaged or encouraged or given the tools to engage in this kind of thought and reflection on how we think and how we build things or make things. Maybe the creative process looks as chaotic as that jumble of wood that's called simplexity. It's like 4,000 pounds of lumber, you know, and inside it is a cube that is absolutely calm and calming to embrace. So instead of running from chaos, the invitation is to embrace it. And so maybe that person's thinking about that. Or they're thinking about and thinking metaphorically and symbolically using that wonderful Newman photograph of the obelisk that's like our civilization, maybe relating it that way. Or that image on the top from Brancusi, it's called the Endless Column, and we're all familiar with it. It's like divergent thinking. Oops, what did I do there? I think I just, okay. He's kind of holding it in his hand. It's a very famous sculpture that when you look at it, it looks like things are diverging, converging infinitely in three-dimensional plane and sphere. And so maybe that's something that is on that individual's mind, or maybe it's something we'd like to teach. All of these things that I'm putting up here, all of these statements and things that are visual statements and propositions, maybe going on inside that individual's mind, and maybe it's something you'd like them to go on their mind in order to help them innovate, in order to help them see the tools and processes that are going on. Much like that Russian nesting doll, that all these things are going on and maybe they're layered in here. Well, we found in the work that we do, I'll just put a couple statements here and run through the last few slides. We found that when you give people basic building materials to work from, not necessarily to make art, okay, but to simply give form to their thoughts and ideas and feelings and views and perspectives, when you give them materials and encourage them, guide them a little, to give form to their thoughts, regardless of what their profession is, what their job is, how they use their multiple intelligences, whether they're logical, mathematical, whether they think spatially or not, when they give form to their thought process and make it tangible, because we are about that. We have been doing that for thousands of years, thinking symbolically and metaphorically. When you allow someone to just, like MacGyver, use any material to show what they know, to see what's on their mind, to see what they feel, what they're experiencing, what happens is a breakthrough happens. Almost every time, like this gentleman who's a chemist in Singapore, who was convinced when he came in the room, nobody would understand his background, his work, because in fact, they're not chemists. They don't have his knowledge base. And so those 100 educators or business people and others that were present when he began to describe that personal model he made about his creative process, he found through the questions that people would ask that, in fact, whether they were talking about a writer or a person with their software company or anything, that they shared similar process, regardless of their cultural background, that they experienced something quite similar. And so that was an interesting awareness that happened. And again, these are things you have to experience because, as I said in the title about the minds-on and hands-on, that there are certain things that I can tell you, but I can't teach you because, in fact, like Galileo said, you can't teach people anything. You can only help them discover it in themselves. And it's the same, you know, I'm sure that's what Duchamp did in a kind of tongue-in-cheek way in 1942 when he used 16 miles of string. And his art contribution wasn't necessarily a painting. It was tethering them all up and linking and showing connectivity between everything. So I want to say this and want to bring the arts into this, as I will bring the science, math, and technology into this, is that for me, art is all representations of thought. It's not simply what we see hanging in museums, not simply what we have seen for thousands of years that and have a certain valuation to them, but rather any kind of mark making that in fact can be interpreted symbolically or metaphorically. That includes gesture and dance and utterances, everything. And so when you open that up and you begin to look at how we experience things by how we define them, and this is the invitation here, is that when you define things more broadly, you tend to experience them differently and in broader context. So here, this process of making models, visualizing ideas, much like we do in science all the time, in engineering and math, just like these folks are doing here. You know, you have the virtual reality one, touching and feeling. We have heard that constantly. And I feel that for an infinite number of time, indefinitely, we will be using both tangible and virtual tools to touch and feel our way through our problems, and try to solve our world problems by doing that. Just like these venture capitalists are doing when they're trying to run their portfolio companies, and they're all huddled around there, and they're using objects, images, words, anything. Anything is fair game to show what they know, to actually build and help one another understand what they're thinking about, what their thought process is, what has to change in the model, which is modeling the reality of how they want to manage a company. And so that process, when you literally, when we use that expression about leveling the playing fields, well, all the technology we're creating now is certainly doing that. But these are everyday common materials that anyone can use, that in fact first graders use, that are in helping them envision and make tangible the thought process. Much like these folks who are CEOs and CFOs trying to figure out where the telecommunications industry is going. And they're not simply telling one another, they're not simply bringing their histograms and going over the logistics and logic of how they're thinking strategically, but they're actually, their hands are in the process, and they're using this as a visual-aided storytelling. We are storytellers. And so they're using this to help one another make the thought process so tangible so that, in fact, they can say, here's what we're envisioning, here's where we're coming from, here are the tools and resources we're building from, here's our present state and our future state, okay? They're not particularly concerned about the aesthetics of it, okay? They're not looking at it and saying, gee, this is going in the Museum of Modern Art. They don't care. But they are using them in a very divisive way, and they are using aesthetics, and they are using the most common basic tools we have around to give form to their ideas and vision. Because, in fact, this statement always seems to prevail, that people can talk, and you can sort of have a 90% capture what they're saying because, in fact, it connects with you on some level. They can look at something and remember a piece of it. But when they're actually doing and building and making, and you'll hear this from Nobel Prize winners. You will hear this from people who are just making breakthrough after breakthrough. That act of touching and feeling your way through a problem is crucial because, in fact, those pictures and models are just encoded with so much information in them. Here is a school teacher who's trying to describe and balance how she balances her passions and interests with her work, okay? Her love of theater arts and choreography and what she has to teach as a science teacher in middle school and how she takes the processes of one thing to teach in the other and tells her story through those objects. And as she's doing that, I put that brain work up here because in fact what we're learning is how the brain is actually encoding. It's called elaborative encoding. It's using all of its modalities, not just visual, to actually make that information stick, okay? Relating it to those processes. Well, I'll zip ahead here and say in my own work, just put a thought and then put a statement there. This is one interesting, curious character named Richard Feynman who would say, what I cannot create, I do not understand. And so everything I'm talking about, when I build my art installations, okay, when I put and integrate the art and science and technology and engineering, all that stuff together, and I make objects like this structure, the encoded monolith, that's supposed to embody how we think and how we create and connect and put ideas and information together and write books and put things inside those. If no one opened those drawers, no one would know who you are, what you're about. You would just be this monolith, much like that figure that was sitting in the corner there. And I will build art installations like this giant thing that you need roller skates to see. It's about a 12-story building turned on its side. It's called Thought Assemblies, and it's trying to visualize the creative process we go through when, again, we're looking at vast amounts of information and sorting out and trying to figure out its form, its architecture. Much like people who are designing, you know, large platforms for the internet and others are trying to map out how that information is going to flow and what it will look like. So I will often invent new technology to actually make these innovations kind of come alive. And these are all about the human thought process. They're like a brain theater of mental imagery. And I look at these structures, and for me, the arts and science and technology and engineering, all of these fields, like that Bucky Fuller quote, are going to come together in this beautiful confluence, which is what's happening now. That in fact, all these fields are beginning to merge, and these environments are welcoming this kind of mergence and this larger integration, where people do get to reflect on. Those little black marks are the beats of time over milliseconds or millennia, that even our notions of time and space and all of it are being challenged now completely, which will challenge how we invent, how we innovate, the tools we use to do it. So you will walk into art environments or whatever they call them, whatever they will call them, and you will be enabled and encouraged to reflect on these things, much like those giant log-like things are like whole civilizations rising and falling, all 26 of them. So you wonder, as we move along, as we evolve, as we look towards that sustainable future, just like you're looking at and being in these environments and pulled to it, you're asked, you're invited to say, what do you envision this future is going to be? Are we going to be living in that chaos? These are all like fragmented, dissociated pieces of information and knowledge, of which that chaos, instead of running from it, again, embracing it, going into it, finding some calm in the storm, will that be our future state, or will it be a completely different future state? And what tools and things can we use to actually build it? Much like that statement and these business leaders who are trying to use tools like this to envision their future and actually embody and create it. So I'll leave you with this little thought about our regulatory signs for inventing and innovating. Is I find one that to literally unchain your brain the way children do, you know, to absolutely leave yourself open, exposed to the whole vista and range of experiences that are there, ever present, and to use anything as a tool to help you innovate, absolutely anything. And it's fair game. To transcend that compartmentalized thinking, which to me is, I know we need it because of the complexity, but not at the expense of reintegrating things. Because as I said before, we tend to experience things by how we define them. if you define art a certain way, or science or engineering or any of those things. And so it forces you to say, how do we define individually for ourselves invention, innovation, discovery, all those different things, and to show yourself how you do it and show others how you do it. To see that bigger picture of innovation, what it means to you, that's like seeing the cosmos there, to envision new possibilities for innovating, and to be that expert novice, always suspending what you know in order to discover what you don't know. You know, going back to that larger statement and giving yourself that green life to do that. And so I'm gonna end on this thought about that framing and the way we frame our knowledge and the way we see our knowledge and the way that as you broaden your perspectives and broaden your experiences and allow yourself the redefinition of invention and how we will do that, how that will absolutely influence your behaviors and actions. And finally, to leave it on this reflection. And that is, genius is everywhere, every day, in everyone, in every way imaginable. And perhaps, in fact, genius is in our genes. Our genes are genius in the way that they allow us to adapt, innovate, grow, learn, do all the different things they've done. Meaning, we're looking for the ox and searching for the ox at the same time. Where it's not a single gene, it's the whole constellation of what enables us to do what we do. So, that was my quick tour jet ski. We're now going to have some very, very smart people get in a conversation about this stuff. So.